No matter what problem you have in your life right now, whether it's a mental health problem, whether it's you trying to concentrate better or be more productive, people are going to recommend that you will need meditation. But does meditation actually work? And if it does, how does it work? What's the science behind it? In this video, I'm not here to tell you that you will need to meditate, but rather I'm about to share the science behind meditation so that you can decide for yourself whether you want it or not. Let's get started. Let's begin with a very common form of meditation called the mindfulness meditation, where you sit quietly, observe your thoughts, breath, body, and sensations without any judgment. And when the mind starts wandering here and there, you gently bring it back and start focusing on one thing. One of the easiest way to get started is to focus on your breath, but you can also focus on a music, a sound, a mantra, or anything you want. So when you look at it closely, we are just doing two things here. The first thing is that we are not letting our mind go into past or the future. We are not thinking about the pending task or the things that we have done in the past. We are just at the present moment. And the second thing is that we are practicing concentration and focus. Now let's have a look at how it affects our brain. There is a part of our brain called the amygdala, and it's something that we had discussed in our anxiety-related video as well. Amygdala is basically the alarm system of the mind, and it is responsible for keeping us alert and worried about a threat. But it is also responsible for some major problems like depression and anxiety disorders. The role of amygdala was very important for our ancestors because when they saw a threat in front of them, it was very important for them to take immediate action. Otherwise, they could have lost their lives. For example, if they saw a predator, an animal in front of them, it was very important to run away. However, if we look at the present time threats that we have, it's not linked to something that we need to take immediate action. For example, the threats mostly can be the fear of not making enough money, the threat of future or uncertainty, or a threat of an upcoming exam, or the threat of losing somebody. Now, these can be real threats, but these are not threats like the one that our ancestors had. It does not require immediate action. However, for our brain, for amygdala, threat is a threat, right? So it believes that we need to do something about it immediately. And that is why we remain worried and restless all the time. And that's what really makes us impatient. And it feels like we are constantly worried about something, missing out on something in our life. And when the amygdala remains really active like this, it can also lead to the overproduction of the stress hormone called the cortisol. Cortisol to some level, to some extent, is good for us because that minimum amount of the stress hormone can help us to stay awake and get things done. But when it is overproduced, it can lead to problems like weight gain, lack of sleep, tiredness, and a lot of different behavioral problems. Now let's talk about how does meditation help in all of these. There are so many studies that have proved that meditation can actually shrink or reduce the size of amygdala. Interesting, isn't it? There is this very famous Harvard study where the researchers took 16 participants who had never meditated in their lives, and they kept them in this 8 weeks mindfulness-based stress reduction program. And in this program, they helped the participants meditate 30 minutes every single day. The MRI scan of the brain of the participants was taken before and after this stress reduction training and before and after meditation. And it was found that the size of the amygdala had reduced noticeably, and the participants could also feel that their stress had gone away to some extent. This happened because when we use a certain part of the brain more repeatedly, then the neural circuits located in that particular part gets activated. New neural connections gets formed there, and that part can actually grow in size. And on the other hand, if we do not use a certain part of the brain, the neural circuits gets less activated, the neural connections gets weak, and that's the reason that part can actually reduce or shrink in size. And the same thing happened with amygdala. When we meditate, we train our mind to calm down and observe our thoughts and emotions without reacting, without alarming the mind. And that is the reason why the activity in the amygdala gets reduced significantly. And because meditation can reduce the size of amygdala, it can also reduce the production of the stress hormone. And that can significantly improve our sleep, maintain good weight, and help us to stay relaxed and calm rather than being tired all the time. Another part of the brain that is heavily affected by meditation is the prefrontal cortex. Prefrontal cortex helps us to focus, make decisions, regulate emotions, and even control our impulses. So if we assume that our body was a company or an organization, then the prefrontal cortex would be its CEO. It means you can understand how important this region of the brain is for us. While amygdala would want us to react to a problem and immediately take action to protect ourselves, prefrontal cortex allows us to think about it and respond to it rather than reacting to it. Now let's come back to meditation and see how it affects the prefrontal cortex. When we meditate, we focus, right? And focusing is one of the major tasks that prefrontal cortex does. So when we focus, the neural circuits in the prefrontal cortex gets activated, like we discussed with amygdala. And that helps to increase the density and thickness in the prefrontal cortex. Now, this can help us to stay present during different tasks and think quicker and better. It can also help us to become better problem solvers. Not only this, if the prefrontal cortex gets stronger, it can now dominate the amygdala, which means even when we are worried and restless all the time, now because the prefrontal cortex is taking the lead, it calms down the amygdala. And it tells us that there's nothing to worry about. It is said that if a person is in their 40s and if they regularly meditate, then their brain would look somewhat like that of a person in their 20s. Now that's something that is a very interesting fact, isn't it? Along with all of this, meditation can also help us in increasing the gray matter in the hippocampus. Now, hippocampus is linked to memory and learning. So when we meditate, we can have a greater memory and can learn things faster. It can also help us in neuroplasticity. Neuroplasticity is our brain's ability to adapt to new things by changing itself. So when we meditate, we are better at neuroplasticity, which means that when we are learning something new, when we are adapting to a new habit or a new environment, our brains helps us better. Along with this, the meditation can also activate the parasympathetic nervous system, which is associated with rest, relax, and recover. When we take deep breaths during meditation and when we relax during meditation, it can help the parasympathetic nervous system to work better and we can recover well and in a much quicker time period. Another very interesting thing about meditation is that it can help us to reduce the pain sensitivity in our body. Pain isn't just about physical or emotional sensations. It's also about how our mind interprets that sensation. There are parts like thalamus and insula, which determines how bad the pain actually is. And when we meditate, we become more mindful, which means the activity in thalamus decreases and less pain signals reach our awareness. And that's how we feel less pain. When the MRI scan was taken between meditators and non-meditators, and when equal amount of pain was given to them, the people who meditated, their brain activity in the region where the pain is experienced was way less than the people who did not meditate. So it's scientifically proven as well. So do you think you are going to give a try to meditation now? Tell me about it in the comments. And hey, before you go, let me know how I can make better videos for you by sending me recommendations. And stay connected with me by subscribing to the channel. I'll see you in the next one.